Welcome to our live streamed or recorded, or best of all, for our seniors, our telephone access worshipers on this snowy Sunday, February 28th of 2021. We are Kelvin Presbyterian Church in Long Lake, Minnesota. My name is Susan Baker, and I'm a member of this church. We thank John Lyman for the flower arrangement he donated in prayerful observance of the Lenten service. And speaking of, if there are other members of Kelvin Church that would like to provide flowers for this season before Easter, you're welcome to contact Tammy Wenz, and she can make that happen for you. Also, we're able to, as we always do at this church, purchase Easter lilies or some other kind of potted plant for our Easter service. Merely send a $14 check to the church, just notate who it's for or in memory of or honor of, and the church will take care of it. Today, we welcome Reverend Leonard Freeman to our pulpit. The Freemans have been partners in worship with us for many, many years, especially as we shared ecumenical services with Reverend Freeman and his congregation at St. Martin's by the Lake Episcopal Church. The Freemans happen to live in a neighborhood that has many Kelvin members in it. So we thank you, Reverend Freeman, for being with us today. Now, let's listen while Mark Bilyeu sets the tone with the prelude for our worship.
Grace to you, and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord, for the hour is coming and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for such the Father seeks to worship him. So now let the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. And now let us listen and pray the prayer for this second Sunday in the season of Lent. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word, Jesus Christ, your Son, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever. Amen.
Now, Reverend Freeman will lead us in our prayer of confession and our assurance of pardon.
Excuse me one moment. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth His praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship Him, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. I pray that while we take a moment to, I will read words of confession. I ask that you take a moment right where you are to open your hearts and to lay them open to the Lord, trusting in His grace for you and for all of us. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought and word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Dear friends, hear the good news. God, through Christ, knows and remembers us with kindness and steadfast love. As far as east is from west, so has God removed our sins. Believe this good news of the gospel. In Christ Jesus, you are forgiven.
Our first scripture reading this morning is taken from Genesis, the 17th chapter, verses 1 through 7 and 15 through 16. The Lord had told Abram, "I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless." Bit of a tall order. Yet God has the same message for us today. God continues with what appears to Abraham and Sarah to be an impossible promise or covenant. Many descendants, many nations would descend from them. God would continue to be with Abraham's descendants who would be given the land of Canaan. When we become part of God's covenant family, the blessings we receive far outweigh what we must give up. Before hearing this Bible reading, let us take a moment to pray. As the scriptures are read, let us hear your voice, O God. Then fill our hearts with meaning and truth, so that we may live what we have learned and be a bit more wise and prudent. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you and will make you exceedingly numerous." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." And God said to Abraham, "As for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her."
I want Jesus to walk with me.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark, 8th chapter, beginning at the 31st verse. Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Now he said all this openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for the sake of my sake and the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with the angels." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, it's nice to be with you, and if I seem to stumble around a little bit, it's because Roger Azell, who was my neighbor across the street for 23 years, Roger and I would kid each other about the differences between our liturgical and Presbyterian liturgical worship and how we did things. And by the way, Roxanne says to say hello. From our Genesis lesson. "Your name shall be no longer be Abram, but Abraham. I will establish my covenant between me and your offspring after you, an everlasting covenant. As for Sarai, your wife, Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her." From our gospel. "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with holy angels." Our two lessons assigned for this morning seem at first blush to be essentially unconnected. One of them is a story of beginnings and promises, and the other warnings and in the midst of the onset of conflict coming up. When that happens, I always try to find in myself, okay, what's the through line? What's going on between them? Now, in Genesis, we have a beginning story of Abram's accepting the Lord's call to leave the land of his ancestors and go out towards a promised land on the basis of God's promises. And because of that trust, the act of faith, as St. Paul and Martin Luther later noted, that faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. And as a mark of that change, Abram is given a new name. Now, whenever you see a name change in the Bible, holy things are going on. Previously, Abram was just another well-respected man. Abram in Hebrew means exalted father. And now he will be Abraham. In Hebrew, the father of multitudes, the father of many nations going forward through time right down to our time, his story will reach out with an eternal covenant. And Sarai, his wife, in Hebrew, Sarai means princess. And now she will be Sarah. Now, it's a name that sounds familiar, but in fact, Sarah is the feminine form of the Hebrew word sar, which means captain or commander. So no longer will she just be a princess. She's going to become a princess commander. The yet childless Sarah's offspring will not just be many, but a source of leadership through time. Kings of people shall come from her. Leadership. So here we have a seminal story about God entering into a basic covenant contract with our ancestors, and Abraham's acceptance of the Lord's call to leave the land of his ancestors and go forth. And on the other side, in this morning's gospel, Jesus is about to get a name change too. We're at a linchpin moment that lies just outside the words we read this morning, because what we read this morning lies between two notable moments. In the very next passage in the Bible, literally the next line, Jesus will go up into the mountain with Peter, James, and John in what's called the Transfiguration, where a voice from the clouds will tell them, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him." And in the words just before this one, literally in the last line in the sentence that precedes our lesson's first sentence, Peter will give Jesus a new name. You are the Messiah. No longer just Jesus. Now, Jesus Christ. This is the first time in the Gospel of Mark that the name Christ is spoken of him. Holy things are going on with name changes. And in this time of change, other shifts are happening. For the first time, Jesus reveals to his disciples that all is not going to go smoothly in this world's terms. There's going to be suffering and rejection, and he will be killed. It's time to choose up sides, he tells them. So the through line, the churches in their wisdom put these things together for a reason. What is God saying to us through them this morning? We have a story of promise and beginnings and covenants and a story of coming conflict, both marked by a change of names, which to me goes to two places. One, are there changes of name, changes of identity arising in the world that you and I live in? Now, changes of name and identity could well be personal, as well as group out there, a marriage, a change of status name. You've just become a grandmother, now you're an uncle, or a widow or a widower. You've received a new job title at work. And how does that change things about how you see yourself and others see you? How does it change the game? Because in life, and if you've experienced any of these things, it changes the game. There are also name changes, identity changes we go through as communities. I don't know about you, but I recently, finally, with the lines of distribution for the COVID vaccine, I faced into a new community identity that I've resisted till now. I really am part of the community of the elderly. Elderly? Shut your mouth. A time of change indeed. I think I've resisted seeing myself that way for years. And then the society puts the name on you, go, okay. And you all, you're going through a potential identity change here, Calvin Church. Name change? I don't know, identity change. As this community of Calvin Church, what does a moment like this mark and tell you? Is the identity of who you were still who you are? Which takes me to the second place. In times such as these, it is important to remember the promises. The stories of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of Sarah and Rebecca and Ruth and of Jesus, that you and I are part of something that's eternal, that continues, part of a stream of history and faith that does not and will not go away, but rather through whom God's love flows into our world. We are part of a people through whom, as Sarah's line says, through whom leaders are generated for the good of this world, through whom people with morals and values and hope and a vision are generated for the good of this world. And heirs of hope, as Paul says about the new covenant in Jesus, heirs of hope despite any of the world's momentary images to the contrary. Any moment of life, any form of structure, is always temporary. And our experience is that God produces new ones. Now you think about the structures through which God works. We use these things called parish churches, congregations. But it wasn't always that way. If you know much of the history of Western Europe, actually the church first used monasteries. And monasteries were the way the church grew, because when you went into wild, untamed territory that was lawless, you built basically a little fortress town that you all could live in and would be safe. It's why the monasteries were not only the churches and the way the church grew in the Middle Ages, it's why they were the hotels of the Middle Ages. It's the place you could get to that was safe and could grow. And that's how the church grew. And then when finally we created towns and there was some sorts of sense of safety around, we created neighborhood churches like the one we're in. Society changed. We created towns when we no longer needed fortresses. And then those turned into, well, when we created urban societies and moved from kind of rural societies, we created the churches where the trolley lines were and the bus lines were. I don't know if you know much about Minneapolis, but I'm from the East, and in Philadelphia, I can tell you there was a church at almost every other trolley line stop. Obviously, as we changed from trolleys and moved elsewhere, we all got cars, all of a sudden there were a lot of churches where we didn't need churches. And we grew churches in the suburbs. Who knows where we go next? We're all talking to each other on Zoom and live stream right now, and God willing, we all get this under control and we don't all have to talk to each other for Zoom for the next 20 years. Getting together is much nicer. But the promise, you see, is never that things and structures will not change. Abraham's holy action was precisely to leave the land of his ancestors and strike out towards new territory, towards a promised land that he hadn't a clue about where it was or what it would look like when he got there. Part of the work of faith and faith communities is to survive. To survive and grow so that the form of survival can take many different forms, new forms within the forms we have, but part of the basic job of faith communities is to stay alive, to spread the faith in whatever way comes forward next for us. The promise is that God has promised us, that we are part of the generations through whom God's love flows into the world. And that work and that life within and around us never ends. Never ends. It is always moving us toward salvation and grace in whatever form it takes. God bless you. Amen.
Thank you.
Now we come to a part that is, well, the second thing that is in every Christian service. The first is the Lord's Prayer. It shows up in any kind of service you will ever do. But the second is the offertory call. The church needs your help so that it can help the world. And so we pray that you will give generously, and you can put that in the mail to Calvin Church, or I am told that you can go online, and there is a way online that you make your pledge, your contribution. God bless you. So now let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. For all things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. Now it is time to offer up our own prayers, our prayers of the people in which we pray for those things in our lives that we need, those things in this life that we are thankful for. We pray for those things in our lives that have not gone the way we wish they had, and we are appreciative of God's grace towards us. I'm going to do a series of little paragraphs and pause just for a second after each. There'll come some that involve prayers specifically for people, and I'll pause so that you can pray for those particular concerns or issues you have on your heart, and also for those thanksgivings you have. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. For this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. For the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy, particularly those who are ministering to those with COVID-19. For the peace and the unity of the Church of God, for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth, for all ministers and all who serve God in His church. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, especially as Calvin seeks a new pastor, that they may be open to the opportunities of their journey ahead and your call for them to continue in reaching out to one another in love and compassion for the health and maintenance of their common life together. Lord, we raise up to you all who are in any sort of difficulty, illness, or need, those who hunger, those in need of housing, those suffering from COVID-19, those in need of vaccine, and all other persons and concerns that are on our hearts. We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom, especially the Reverend Roger Ezell and others who may be on our hearts. Let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon them who put their trust in you. And finally, dear Lord, we thank you for all the blessings of our lives. We will exalt you, O God, our King, and praise your name forever and ever. Amen. And now let us join together in the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Go forth now into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you now and always.
Continue to give you hope and keep you strong and make
Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.